Hello everyone, this is Amir from Audio Science Review. This is another episode in looking at what's inside high resolution music. This analysis is a little different in, and it's by request to look at the high resolution samples provided by the great label 2L, the Nordic Sound, as you can see their website over here. They distribute pretty high quality music, but another service they provide, which is wonderful for the community, is this sampler page where you can actually download music for free at practically every sample rate and resolution that you might be interested in, all the way from CD quality to DXD in stereo, 352 kilohertz sampling rate. So it makes for a wonderful workbench to look at what's inside high resolution music. They nicely tell you what the source format is. In this case is DXD, so this large file at 410 megabytes is the original master in stereo. Then there are versions in stereo. I have the 96 kilohertz version, and I've also downloaded the MQA and CD. So let's go ahead and look at these files in addition. I'm going to start with 96 kilohertz sampling rate, and let me move this back to somewhere interesting. And before I even play the music, if you've watched my previous episodes, you already see the problem. Look at these three peaks in here. They're occurring 38 kilohertz on up. Obviously, they're not musical information. As I've explained before, music has this nice exponential roll-off, more or less, and there is no musical instrument that just generates these high, very narrow, pure tones, almost signals way into ultrasound. Whoever produced the master this music, just like me and the rest of you, can't hear those, so what they didn't hear, they didn't catch. But they should have just done this simple objective analysis. This window of frequency analysis exists in every audio application. So they could have just pulled this up, found these, and eliminated their sources. What are the sources? The pure ones, again, as I've explained before, probably the scan rate of monitors bleeding into the sensitive inputs of the analog to digital converter. These wider noise ones are less pure. You know, there could be alarms in the building, or if it's captured from tape, which I don't think this one is, it could have been bias signals that are used on reel-to-reel tape recorders. But regardless, it's not our job to discover what they are. It is theirs. They could easily turn equipment on and off until these peaks go away and not deliver these to us. Another nice phenomenon we see that's good learning exercise is that as we get close to our final frequency of 48 kilohertz, which is the bandwidth we can have in a 96 kilohertz sampling, you can see this nice anti-aliasing filter that necessary to get rid of what is called aliasing. And it pulls things down to minus 180 dBFS, which is great. So that's natural, that's good. What's not good is this. So let's go ahead and play the music and see if we can figure out what the usable spectrum of music is, how much of this we really needed. So clearly this part is going up, but if we let it play, we see that it actually does use the rest of the most of the rest of the spectrum also. Let it get louder. See, you can see this part is jumping in correlation with music, and that's important lesson to learn. Music is not a random thing. An instrument that plays at this frequency has overtones that play here, and the two have to be correlated. If there's nothing here, then there's just noise, but a real instrument generating high frequencies will extend. Here is a good example. You can see how naturally it extends. So I'd say eyeballing it, about 34 kilohertz is what we need to preserve. Doubling that to get the sampling rate, that would have been 68 kilohertz. We don't have 68 kilohertz sampling rate, and the nearest one would be 88 kilohertz. So for this kind of music, well, the original capture should have been 88 kilohertz. and that unfortunately would have captured some of these tones, but wouldn't have delivered to us a bunch of extra noise. Now here, the extra noise, 88 the difference between 88 kilohertz and 96 kilohertz is not that large. But now let's go to the original master and see how wasteful this is. So this horizontal scale is hugely expanded. This is 352 kilohertz sampling. So the bandwidth is now half of it, or 180 kilohertz or so. And if we go back to the previous display truncated around here. We still see our original ultrasonic tone in here, still present. And but what's right after that, we see this hugely rising noise pattern. And that's typical of low bit rate or one bit sampling. Because we don't have sufficient number of bits, normally tons of distortion would be generated in the audible band. There's a process called noise shaping, where we take noise out of the audible band and shove it into ultrasonic range. The idea being that we can hear noise in the audible band, but we can't hear it in the ultrasonic range. So all the noise has been emptied out of here and shoved into the ultrasonic. By definition then, we don't want to play this. This is noise that is not musical information. It should be thrown away. And the idea was that we don't hear it and throw it away. Indeed, some SACD players, or I don't know if all of them, have a selectable filter to actually, analog filter, to actually get rid of this noise and this hash that's coming out. Yet in the case of high resolution digital download, we're now handing all this to users, and people happily go for the larger number being better. 352 is much nicer sounding than 96 kilohertz. So let's get all that and attempt to play that. So nothing good comes out of playing this noise on your stereo. The amplifier may oscillate, may distort. Your tweeter may cook, may distort, may cause intermodulation. It may actually generate distortions in the audible band, or may do nothing. And that's the best case situation where it does nothing. No reason to distribute all this. No reason to originally capture that such a high sample rate. Again, an 88 kilohertz sampling rate would have been plenty, would have been just nice, and it would have truncated everything to the right. So no goodness comes out of this. Now, scaling all the way down to what would have been a CD release, let's go ahead and listen to the 16-bit 44.1 kilohertz sampling. So now our horizontal scale truncates down to 22 kilohertz or so. And let's play this content again. And let me see if I can find, yeah, there we go. Oops. Pay attention to here when it gets quiet. There. Did you see this peak point out? Peaking out? This is a pure tone again, or set of tones. They're not musical. That's not part of music. We can see the level of the music is naturally dropping off, but this part is not. It gets masked when the music gets louder than it, but otherwise it peaks out. This is much more problematic than the high frequency ones because it's in the audible range. It's about 19 point some kilohertz. Was it caused by? I don't know. Some instrument, something electronic is generating it. It's unfortunate. I mean, this is egregious. Means even in CD we're hearing it. Let me play that some more. There it is. You can see it very clearly peaking up. Now, it's very low level, but, you know, still, we want to have good quality. There it is. I mean, it's just unmistakable that this is not natural. Nothing here does that. You see this nice exponential clean roll off, and she should have sailed into the sunset the same way. So unfortunate for sure. Now, lastly, let's get into a new format called MQA, Master Quality Audio. It's a new format being introduced, and its claim to fame is that it encodes high-resolution audio, high sample rate audio, into low sample rate distribution format. In this case, 24-bit 48 kilohertz, I believe. Let's open that up. No, this one is actually 44 kilohertz sampling rate. And but inside this, you can actually decode and get the what used to be above here. And how does it do that? Well, if you go back to the original display, we can see how it's going to do that. This area is the audible frequency range, and we, you know, PCM format, let's, you know, 16 or 24 bits is spent encoding this. But as we get to our ultrasonic, if you look at the levels in here, 125 dB EFS, these are very, very low level signals. No way do we need to have a dynamic range that describes them all the way up to zero. I've never seen any high resolution content that's much of anything above these very, very low levels. So what we really need is just a few bits to encode this spectrum. And that's indeed what MQA does. If we go back to the MQA signal, let me zoom out a little bit. We see what looks like a CD rate, but then we see a strange phenomenon over here where the noise floor rises in here. Why is the noise floor rising here? Because in here, MQA actually attempts to encode the information it needs to generate the rest of the bandwidth to the right. And so in that regard, it is degrading the CD rate. No question about it. This is very, very low level. Audibility is a different question than objective measurement. But if we play this, we can see that this part of this rising spectrum did not exist. Now, luckily, a lot of it is above ultrasonic, and again, for us old folks, we don't hear it. But the rise starts around 16 kilohertz or so. So clearly, the very high frequencies have had a random noise added to them. And that information actually isn't random. It's actually correlated to what spectrum it wants to generate above this point, but it's been randomized to make its audibility very difficult. I haven't done any double blind tests to see if I can hear that. I believe others have, and they sort of kind of could. So at the extreme, this may be audible depending on the content you play. So there's a price to be paid. It's backwards compatible, MQA is. That means just as I'm doing right now, I'm playing this without MQA decoding, yet the music plays and I hear it. But there's a compromise in embedding that in here. I believe for other content, they use 48 kilohertz sampling, which allows this to be shoved further up above the audible band. Right now, it's at 16 kilohertz. So that's it. Hopefully, you're finding these episodes useful. I know music's about art and enjoyment and not about what's going on in here, but I think the industry needs to do a better job in producing and delivering high-resolution content to us that's pristine, that's clean, because that's what we pay for. We pay a lot more for these high-resolution downloads. They're not on sale for next to nothing on Amazon to go and buy the CD. And so we expect, and rightfully so, pristine quality masters and not something that has extra tones in it, and noises, and what have you. Okay. Again, this is Amir from AudioScienceReview.com. Talk to you later in a future episode. Bye-bye.